This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Melinda Leslie is back with us. We did a great show a couple of weeks ago, and everyone seems to have asked me the same question. What about my labs, and what about hybrids? She knows so much about these things, but you hardly touched on it, because we spent so much time talking about the other thing that she does, which is sightings tours. And before we go in, and we're going to spend this show exclusively on my labs, that's military abductions, and on hybrids and hybridization. And we both know a lot about hybrids. I don't know much about military abductions, hopefully. I'm not sure. But in any case, why don't you start by telling us kind of where you are with the sightings tours? What's been going on lately?
Well, now, I just attended the MUFON symposium in Las Vegas, and so I was out of town and then extended the trip for a couple extra days for fun in Vegas. Had a great time. And but prior to that, I've completed, what tour number am I on? I think I'm on 1,408 or 1,409. So I'll just be a little more conservative and say 1,408 tours that I've completed. And it just keeps going strong. We keep having amazing sightings. You know, someone just had posted something online about, just yesterday, about the commonality of people seeing three separate objects in a triangle formation, not a single triangular
yes.
craft, but separate objects, and posted some pictures, a little video. And I responded to them and said, yeah, like, we see that. Three things in a triangle formation, I would say about twice a month on my tours, you know, so we see that pretty often. We get doubles all the time, two things flying in unison, and then sometimes three, and often if there are three, they're in a triangle formation. And so we see that very commonly. And, you know, someone was posting, oh, how many people out there have seen this? And I go, well, it's hundreds of times, thousands of times, you know.
Yeah.
And because again, we see it, you know, roughly, I'd say about twice a month. So, we're still, you know, seeing stuff. Last time we saw fully structured craft, meaning seeing hard edge, you know, metal kind of thing, or at least a very distinct shape that me and my clients all agreed on, that was earlier in the year. I'd say that was 6 months ago anyway. So, but otherwise we're, you know, we're seeing things stop, turn, change direction, shoot off, flying formations, occasionally very unusual patterns, abrupt right angle turns. I mean, we've seen all these things in the last couple of weeks. So yeah, it's still going strong.
Well, good. I'm glad to hear it. And you know, that triangle formation is very interesting. At first, it's characteristic of the phenomenon, and I have quite a few people I've known who have seen, when they see a triangle formation that seems somehow close to them and moving along, they very often end up in an abduction scenario. Now, but the other thing about the triangle formation is that is the oldest philosophical symbol in the world. It is the secret of the Sphinx, but it's also what Buckminster Fuller called the building block of the universe, and it is the core structure of the atom. So when they come in a triangular formation, they're really saying something very fundamental there about the whole nature of reality. So I'm not too surprised that we see that a lot. But now let's go on, and let's talk first about my labs, military abductions. And can you begin by telling us your introduction to this? What first happened to you, or did you first hear? I'm not sure if you had an experience or began with research, but where did you begin with the whole my lab issue?
Yes, that's a very good question. How I first got into it was my own experiences, trying to figure out what had happened to me. And then that quickly grew from kind of what I call investigating my own experience to meeting other people that it had it happen, and et cetera. Now, I probably should clarify, we're assuming that people out there, and probably the majority of people listening, do know what the term MILAPS means, but there's a lot of incorrect information out there, too, or at least information that is not in alignment with my research. So I should, you know, preface it that way. And now I've been doing research in that field, and I'm kind of known somewhat the last man standing, if you will, in ufology, kind of by default, to be the last person kind of focusing on that. Other people have either pulled out of this field or passed away. But I stand on the shoulder of giants, thank God. So it started with investigating my own experiences. And I'll qualify, I guess, for everyone what MILAPS is. M-I-L for military and A-B for abduction. It's people who have, in my research, I have focused and kind of had, limited focus on saying it is people with alien abduction experiences who then get targeted by covert human agencies. And you can have follow-up harassment and surveillance happen, monitoring. You can be picked up by covert humans and interrogated about your alien abduction experiences, have follow-up medical things at the hands of humans who are checking on what the ETs possibly did with you, et cetera, et cetera. And it can start off very low grade as far as monitoring, what I would call it, some harassment and surveillance kind of things. And then it can pick up to more and more involvement. And then it can ramp up to people getting recruited into advanced programs for covert human operations. For instance, people are used for anything like spying on the ETs to being perpetrators of these events and get recruited into those programs and get recruited into psi programs for their psi abilities. It's well known amongst abductees and abduction research. I know I'm preaching to the choir here with you for sure, which is, it's kind of the running joke, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Well, which came first, the psychic or the abductee? All abductees are psychic. I don't think all psychics are necessarily abductees. I know quite a few that I work with and whatnot that claim to not have any of the abduction stuff. But it's very, very common for abductees to have kind of developed the psi abilities and get in touch with that. And that's part of the whole learning and discovery process. And so it goes hand in hand with it. Like I said, I know you're very well versed in it.
you should. Yeah. You're not and, kidding.
So that's one of the things that the covert guys are interested in the abductees. So there seems to be five predominant areas of research they're interested in. But going back, I'll get into that in a minute, but going back to just answering your question, yeah, it started with my realizing I had my own experiences with it. What really kicked that off, well, I was having in the early 90s, starting in 1990, I discovered I was an alien abductee in late 89, a trip to Area 51 in Nevada on a last-minute fluke. It was the breaking of the Bob Lazar story at the time. And a friend of mine said, let's go out and check this out. And we went out to Nevada and had amazing sightings. Something about having all those sightings was like turning a key and inserting it, or inserting a key and turning it, I should say, and unlocking in my head all these memories of childhood, teenage, young adult abduction experiences And then I started to have current present time experiences. For instance, I had a roommate of mine witness quite a few things that was happening to me. And so I'm not sure if I went into any detail about that the last time I was on with you. I may have. So that was happening and learning I was having the alien abduction. And then I started to have the harassment surveillance, the infamous what are called black helicopter incidents of black helicopter flyovers. And, one time, there was a series of times, I was living in Corona Del Mar, California, and there's this black helicopters that kept coming around and circling right over where I lived, a little one-story apartment, long story short. And there were neighbors who lived across the street from me, long story short again, who one day, like the day after another helicopter thing had happened, and I'm quoting my neighbor, they said, gosh, it's like we live in L.A. Well, we were in Corona Del Mar, California, sleepy little oceanside community, And she goes, it's like we live in downtown L.A. or something, and helicopters are always trying to land on our roof. And so I'm quoting my neighbor,
how strange.
That my neighbor noticed, and said, gosh, it's like we live in L.A., and helicopters are always circling and trying to land on our roof. And, one day I go out, and this one is circling, and the bay doors on either side, it was like a big military helicopter, I guess, by Huey or something, But it had big, doors on either side of its main, I guess, what, fuselage, And those were open and it was low as it was circling. And there's like this sun setting behind it. So it was beautifully, backlit through these open doors. And there was a guy leaning out in a harness. It appeared he had a harness of some kind on, leaning out the doors with like a telephoto lens. And so I'm like, I can clearly see him. What's he getting my pores? But, clearly looked like he was probably taking pictures. It's an assumption, but, he definitely had some kind of camera or something like that with a telephoto, it appeared, that he was holding on to. And so it was that kind of very, very blatant. And back then I kind of began to realize it was, yes, it's surveillance and monitoring, sure. But I think it's also was very much meant to be a form of intimidation. A lot of people, when they have this happen, are intimidated from talking about their experiences or going forward with them. So if part of their purpose is in that, that seems to work, because a lot of abductees who have this happen then do pull back. They get very intimidated by it. That was happening, some other helicopters, some phone stuff. At the time, I had met a well-known abductee back then by the name of Leisha Davidson, and she was having these very bizarre phone things happen, and occasionally when she would call me, I would witness this, and I did a bunch of research back then to learn it was called number stations, where they were, it's a way that agents can notify each other in the field, their location, by leaving these recorded number patterns. And we were getting those, and I did a bunch of research and found that the patterns of numbers and stuff seem to be consistent with that, with the idea of number stations. So, but again, when her and I would talk on the phone, I would get that, as well as back then, because I was becoming more involved in the field and meeting other experiencers and talking to the key researchers in the field, that again, I was having that kind of stuff happen often in conjunction with those phone calls. And learning that I certainly wasn't alone. This happens to quite a few people. And then all of a sudden, what would have been, let me see, I got to remember the dates here. It doesn't matter exactly. But in August and November of 1990, I had two back-to-back experiences where it went beyond the harassment, surveillance, monitoring kind of things. And that was all fairly low grade. It was more just kind of entertaining. I just chalked it all up. And I've always told other experiencers when I work with them with these experiences to say, look, you know, chalk it up to evidence that your experiences are real and important or this wouldn't be happening. So again, you know, the monitoring, the surveillance, the black helicopter and phone stuff and being watched, being followed, having your home under surveillance or, you know, strange vans parked outside, all this kind of stuff comes up very common in this research. Some abductees have gotten very blatant and approached the people that seem to have their home under surveillance and, you know, have had some interesting interactions because they've done that. But going back to, so in first in August, I had an experience where I was then removed from my house at the time and had a MILAB abduction where I was taken by military individuals and then again in November. And so that August and November experiences in 90 really made me go, okay, you know, something else was going on here, you know? And let me see, I'm trying to remember which one was which, because sometimes I get them kind of confused, not that it really matters. But in one of those, I was taken and had a gynecological procedure done. That years later, I met a gynecological surgeon who questioned me about the event and ended up giving me feedback to suggest that I had a what would have been an early term abortion type procedure that happens when a fetus is not formed, like there's a problem with the pregnancy or maybe somewhat even a tubal pregnancy or something like that. Now, at the time, I was not sexually active right then and had no knowledge of being pregnant, but it was very common for me back at that time to have skipped or missed periods and things like that, but that I often had in relationship to my alien abduction experiences and being part of the hybrid program and everything. I know we're going to get into that, but because of that stuff going on, I didn't often worry about things like a missed or late period or something. But all of a sudden I have this experience at the hands of humans where I'm taken from my bedroom, drugged heavily, woken up during the night, and taken to an underground base, and I was put on a stretcher and taken to, like I said, to an underground base, and then having this in this what I would call a hazmat style environment. And I have drawings and stuff that I've done of this, and very skilled artist Bill McDonald drew some of these things for me. I have my original sketches, and then he, using his incredible technical skill, redrew them for me. But I have drawings of that, and so I'm taken to this hazmat style environment on an underground military base, I remember very well the process of them drugging me while I'm at home, taking me out of bed. At some point, I pass out, but I come to in the back of this big semi truck. Yes.
Yeah. First, we got to take a brief break.
Okay.
For our free Dreamlanders, and we're going to do that right now. But before we do that, when we get back, I'm going to ask Melinda a little bit about the why of this. Why is it being done? Because you know, I've just been letting you talk about your own experiences, but it's not like other people don't have them too.
Yeah, that's right.
A lot. I mean, it's really going all the way back to things like the Candy Jones experience, she was Long John Naval's girlfriend, I believe, wife, and she had very similar experiences. And I think I did too when I was a child. So there's something very odd here because it doesn't look like something done by the normal military at all. But it is happening, I think. And as strange as it sounds, there's just too much smoke here for there not to be some fire. We'll be right back. We're talking to Melinda Leslie. Her website, UFO Sightings Tours. Do you have the exact URL, Melinda?
Yes. It's UFOsightingTours.com.
Okay. It's UFOsightingTours.com.
Tours, yeah. Tours
and
with an F.
You can go out to Sedona and probably see a UFO with Melinda, or maybe more than one. It's a pretty regular experience in her sightings tours. And, you know, I have to ask you, and we'll get back to the my labs in just a moment, but you have a very strange life. You're integrated into this thing in some way, because there isn't anyone else who runs sightings tours that are as reliable as yours. You almost never miss. And do you have any idea what it is about you that makes your relationship to this experience and to this so special? It's extraordinary, I think.
Well, I chuckle hearing this from you, Whitley, because you're in such a similar boat as me, you know?
And both of us have got this military stuff in our backgrounds, don't we?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is just this is how it works. Contact permeates your life, and it's ongoing, and it has everything to do with your life. It's just the way contact, I think, works for so many people. You know, we're learning. It came up, I listened this last weekend to these guys with this incredible, they call it the Big Phone Home show, some gentlemen with a podcast called Unidentified Celebrity Review do this amazing kind of three-part. They have a podcast that runs 5 days a week anyways, but they did this 3-day big phone home to cause, to get people motivated to call and write in to their representatives and governmental representatives to get attention to the subject and to help push disclosure forward. And they really took a big thing underway. But the reason I bring that up is one of the things they had were a bunch of military witnesses on this. And one of the things that came up in this panel of these military witnesses on the day that they were on was how common it was for them to also be experiencers. And I think we're finding that more and more, that even these military witnesses are experiencers, are contactees beyond just their significant military sighting event or sighting event outside of the military. As you said earlier, you know, when people say, oh, they see the three things in formation, there's often an abduction, you know. Well, I think if you're having a bunch of sightings, there's a higher increase that you're also a contactee in other ways, whether that's conscious contact or abduction related or, you know, or any combination thereof. But, and even some people who are the very conscious contactees learn that they have the abduction stuff too. There's no definite lines between these things. The edges bleed into each other, you know? And so it's very common for, again, these military witnesses to have realized that they have additional experiences. And I'm hearing more and more from them the guys involved in the Nimitz incident and the Roosevelt incident, and those, you know, have also had contact and are openly talking about it. And you go from, they were not even willing, for instance, the Roosevelt witness guys, not even willing to talk about their sighting like 3 years ago, to now not only talking about it, but talking about their own personal experiences beyond that, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So this is unfolding. Luckily, it's becoming more and more acceptable to share your experiences, to share your sightings. There's a new era of openness, thank God, because of all this disclosure stuff going on and media attention. And so it's opening up the subject matter. And you know, one thing I want to get into a little later is the Millhap stuff. There's so much information packed in it to give us an indication of how much is really known by those who are the secret keepers or in charge of the truth embargo, you know,
Who do you think they are?
They really know a lot more than I think people are letting them off the hook way too often for as much as they really do know about all this.
Who do you think they are? That's the thing that amazes me because, you know, I know other people. Like, I know a guy who had a vivid, like a lucid dream of being involved in a myelab and being abducted by military and taken to a Air Force base that he recognized. And when I suggested to him that this might not have been a dream, he reacted with fury, like he'd been programmed to. It was weird. Because you'd think, I mean, why even tell me about it if when I say, well, gee, maybe it seems like you're talking about something that actually happened, and then he blows up in my face. And then, but after that, the guy was dogged by helicopters for years. And even when he would come up to our cabin every once in a while, there would be helicopter after helicopter passing over the entire time he was there. And they weren't like military helicopters. Most of them looked like regular helicopters. What in the world could be going on, Melinda?
Well, you know, you asked a little while, I think before the break, that you asked why this is going on. And I can tell you that there's predominantly five areas of interest that have come up consistently now in my 30 years of research in the subject and working with hundreds of people that have had this happen. And when I say I work with, I'm not a therapist. I'm not a hypnotherapist. I'm not a therapist. I'm just a researcher and investigator where I interview people with cases. If they're a good evidence case, I gather the evidence and review it and correlate experiences that different people have had together and, you know, just, again, research and investigation. But I've done research and investigation of the hundreds of cases. And so there's five things that come up consistently that the covert guys are interested in. One is the sight component. I already brought that up before, that they're interested in abductees' sight abilities. Or do you remote view? Do you do telepathy? Are you clairvoyant and clairsentient, clairaudient, all those things? And are you able to do it at will and repeatedly, et cetera? And so that in these experiences, sometimes people are tested and trained on those abilities. And so they're very interested in that. So that's psi abilities. One is the technology, of course. They're very interested in, as an abductee, have you had hands-on with the technology? Have you flown or navigated a craft? It's very, very common for abductees to do that, you know, to fly and navigate craft and be at the controls, et cetera. So have you flown or navigated craft? Or have you been shown other technology? Also, I would put in the technology grouping like Have you been shown mathematical formulas? Have you been downloaded or given mathematical formulas or information or alien languages? So I would put all that in that technical, you know, category of technical information. So if you know anything in the, about the propulsion, you know, propulsion, weapons, energy system, navigation, like I said, math formulas and languages, et cetera, you know. So, and so they question the abductees about those things. And the third being alien agenda and motive. What do you know about why the aliens are doing this? What are their agendas, motives? What things are, what have you learned about the ETs? Do you have any thoughts on why they're here, what they're doing? And that leads to the next thing, because what's the agenda and motives, but significantly the hybridization program. So they're interested in the genetics of the abductee. And what kind of genetics, stuff, can they learn from you? Have you been manipulated genetically? Have you been influenced genetically? Are you being used in the hybrid program? Is there something, are you yourself a hybrid? You know, so are you a hybrid? Do you have kids that are hybrids? Is there anything unusual about your genetics? You know, so that whole genetic part of it is another component they're interested in. So that was number four. And I would say number five is the practice and development of mind control techniques. The reason they're able to do these experiences and repress the memories is I can say, you know, they have mind control down to a science.
It is. It must be a science because they do.
Yeah.
Listen, we're going to take another brief break here. Free Dreamlanders, listen up. I'd like to talk to you for a minute about the three books that I've written since Anne passed away. I think in many ways they are by far the three most important books I've ever written, at least in, to my mind. The Afterlife Revolution shows that there really is an afterlife, and I was privileged to have communication with my wife, with Anne, after she passed away, enacted by her in such a way that it was undeniable. The second book, A New World, is about communicating with the visitors, but in a real way. It's the only book of its kind in the world. There isn't another book like it, because quite frankly, there isn't anybody else who can do this like I can. I've been doing it for 30 years, or more than 30 years now, maybe for my whole life even. I think this is a unique book, I have to tell you. And the next one, Jesus, A New Vision, is also a vision of how we need to live if we're going to make contact work. It is totally outside of the context of war and weapons and so forth. It's about Jesus and living as he lived and he taught us for the good, on behalf of the good, and with the good in your heart, in your soul, in your blood, and your body. So if you have not read these three books, go to Amazon and get them and read them, or go to Audible and get them and listen to them. Bring them into your heart, because the three books together are a whole new way of looking at life, what it is, and where we are going.
The new Unknown Country is becoming a social hotspot for people interested in UFOs, ETs, the contact phenomenon, and so much more. Becoming a site user is free and enables you to participate in our active free message boards. And if you join as a paid subscriber, you'll also gain access to our weekly subscriber chats and video meetings, plus access to our podcast archives, meditations, video section, and so much more. So join free or subscribe. Either way, unknowncountry.com belongs in your life.
We're talking to Melinda Leslie, her website, UFO Sighting Tours, and you can go to Sedona and you probably will have a sighting experience if you go on one of Melinda's tours, because that happens most of the time. And I'm still amazed by that. I'm going to do this soon. I was hoping to do it in September, but there's too much COVID floating around still, so I'm waiting for things to die down or whatever I need to do to be sure I'm comfortable going. All right. Now, we were talking before we just briefly left the air about people's My Lab experiences and their connection with this. And, you know, we're kind of going to have to leave that behind because we know there's a connection. I have a connection. You have a connection. Many, many people do. What we don't know is how this relates to our military. Is it something like Richard Dolan proposes, a kind of breakaway civilization, like a part of the military that's breakaway? Or is it somehow integrated into the normal military and a lot of people know about it and they just never say anything? Because, you know, there's lots of whistleblowers out there. And lots of older people, especially like Art Exon or Jesse Marcel, who will fess up toward the end of their lives. But not about this. No, sir. Not about this. Now, what I want to do is I want to shift gears. I want to go on to hybrids. I have seen and interacted with a hybrid and two men who were with him who were, I don't know what they were, frankly. I think they might have been human. And I've talked about that a lot and written about it in my books. It's discussed in A New World. It's discussed in Solving the Communion Enigma, and it's discussed in Supernatural. So I'm not going to go into that here, except to say that it involved what looked like an 11-year-old boy who was no ordinary boy. And he had the ability to read your mind. He was very distressed and very disturbed. He followed us from upstate to New York to San Antonio. And I finally drove him away by putting an automatic motion-sensitive light up in the little corner where he was hiding in the condo complex. And since then, I've regretted it. And I've wished that I had had more of an ability to engage with him. But why don't you start now telling us your story about hybrids, because it's an extraordinary story.
Sure. Just curious, and I know you and I have also spoken a little bit privately about that same experience that you just shared. Have you, on board, been shown the hybrid children of any age, whether it was newborns, toddlers, up to kids or teens or adults? Have you seen hybrids in your experience?
I'm not sure. Anne and I saw a baby, but that is another story. And I don't know if it was a hybrid baby or our baby or exactly what was going on. But that also is a commonplace part of this experience. And it's too familiar. I mean, too many people have seen that. Goodness knows.
Yeah. And well, that's the hybrid. Okay. Well, a lot of the leading abduction researchers for many years have said, and there's probably truth to this, that one of the leading reasons there's the alien abduction phenomena is the hybridization program, because even though many things happen in alien abduction events, you can be taught and shown all sorts of interesting things, tested emotionally, enhanced your psi abilities, shown earth catastrophe and functions, and given warnings about taking care of the planet and the environment, and, you know, all these things that are now established as common in the abduction. But there's still kind of a number one that seems to happen the most, and that is the presentation of hybrids and the taking of eggs or ovum from women and sperm from men and the production of these hybrid beings. So this is very common in the experience. And we can speculate as to why that might be, but we've never really known for sure why they're doing that. Many abductees feel that they're raising hybrid children and that their own children here on Earth are hybrids. I know quite a few abductees. One of them has quite a few kids and feels that about half of them are hybrids and the other half aren't, you know. Now they're human beings for all intents and purposes. They're a human. They just happen to have some ET DNA. But some people have had like yourself, you know, maybe the one teenage hybrid experience involvement in your life, and maybe you and Ann, like you said, on board ship may have been shown another hybrid child. Okay. Some people have had it once, twice, three times. Some people have had it. I think of Jesse Long, abductee, that I think had 12 or 15 hybrid presentations, maybe more than that. I'd have to double check the information. I know another person that claims they had about 40, 45 hybrid presentations. You know, so I know that the numbers can be quite high with that. And these are credible people. These are people with well-established cases and evidence and, you know, and who have good memory of their experiences and maybe a lot of regressive hypnosis as well. So they seem to be, you know, pretty clear about it. I was in a movie, for those interested in exploring this further, I was in a movie I'm very, very proud to have been in called Extraordinary The Seeding. I had a part in that and was exceptionally proud because it explored this subject and its complexities and its difficulties and what it is emotionally for the people who've been through it. It's very, very emotional. I mean, I know when I talk to you privately about your own experience, it's exceptionally emotional, as well as it is for me. Now, with me, I've had three child hybrid presentations, and then one of those I was presented again as an adult, and I'm happy to share that if you want me to. It takes a little while, but I can get into it if you want me to.
Yeah, why not?
Okay. So I'll start with, the three child presentations, one of them was an alien abduction where I'm taken on board craft in from where I lived at the time. And, you know, I've had so many alien abductions. They start to blur together. Many of them are very similar to each other. And this one, they took me and proceeded to take over from me. And they took me down a hallway. There's more detail about all that, but it doesn't matter right now. And they took me into a room and they showed me what was like an empty crib. And then they showed me an apparatus on the wall that was supposed to represent male genitalia and sex in some way. And they were like, okay, we've done this before. And I'm trying to figure out what are they trying to show me here. And we're going to do this again. And they showed me like an empty crib set up. But they just took over them. And I said, well, that, you know, would be quite a, probably a while away, you know, from being needing the crib, but okay. And they showed that to me. And then all of a sudden, they bring in this little girl into the room. And they didn't tell me her age, but I want to say she looked about 5 or 6. And very unusual looking, very high forehead, much more looking like a gray alien than a human, but thin, sparse hair, kind of had this long sleeve, kind of loose shift on, very high forehead, big oversized eyes, great big pupils with a little blue iris around a giant oversized pupil, little blue thin iris around that. And then the whites in the corners of the eye, and very slight, kind of pointy little chin, And at that point, or years later, I should say, years later, I saw images that were exactly like what I saw. So even though it was so strange at the time, over the years of my involvement in abduction research, I can say that what I saw was very, very common and very commonly reported by other people, down to the hair and the dress and the and her slight build and her elongated head and everything. But she was very startling, and when they showed her to me, I looked away, like they just brought her in the room kind of behind me, long story short. Anyways, I looked away, and they must interpret that as the Grays, interpret that as something was wrong, and they proceeded to escort her quickly out the room, and they took her down the hallway, and I was like, wait. I mean, I didn't say anything. I was just like frozen in shock, but I wanted to say, wait, come back, you know? But they took her down this hallway, and I watched her walk off, you know, into the distance. And I always had extreme guilt that I had turned away from my own child. And I mean, really, really extreme guilt. When I would think of the experience, I'd cry. And it was really tough. Like, oh my God, was that my own kid? And I should have embraced her and said, I love you and, you know, whatever. And instead I was just like, it was just so shocking, you know? And so they interpreted, I guess, the look on my face or my negative reaction at the time to something was wrong, and maybe didn't want to upset her, I guess, you know, or didn't want to upset me further or both. So they took her out of the room and ran her down the hallway. And so I'm like, oh, you know, and so I always had, like I said, extreme guilt over that. And then jumping ahead, I had another time with a little boy that I didn't get a good look at. It was kind of a combination of, I think, ship memory and screen memory, because I remember being on a ship, but being in a room where there was this big stone fireplace. So I'm like, that's not making sense. But this big stone fireplace thing, and my original memory of this experience was kind of a classic big round stone house in a field abduction scenario of realizing that was actually screen memory for a ship, that there wasn't a round house in the field, that there was a ship. But at this time, I saw this little boy that I didn't get a good look at. He was probably 2 or 3 years in age. Again, had a sleeveless kind of little shift on and a kind of a page boy haircut. And I wish I'd gotten a better look at him. And then there was a third experience of being handed a toddler. I remember this experience of going on board a ship through some kind of energy room and a cleansing process they took me through. And then they have this area that was like set up as if to look like somebody's master bedroom or something, I think, to bring a level of comfort and home feeling or something. But yet I was clearly on the ship. And that time I was handed this toddler and I held him, and he was, for all intents and purposes, a fully like a 10-month-old child, you know, human. And so I knew I was, if it was a hybrid, it was very much mostly human, you know, like it was holding, I was just holding a 10-month-old baby, very cute. And a year after that experience, I was babysitting a nephew of mine who was at the time 10 months old. And I'm holding him and I'm tripping out because this nephew of mine at 10 months old looked exactly like the kid I held a year earlier. Like, now I'm not saying I was holding my nephew ahead of time or anything, but the fact that this was my kid and my genetics, there was no mistake. Like, you know, my nieces and nephews as children had a certain look. They all kind of look like my dad, long story short. And so, so it was very, you know, clear that this was my genetics, my kid, and that one I held. And so I felt like I didn't want to do the mistakes of before of either looking away and or not approaching and not engaging. So this time I held this kid until they said, you have to go now. You know, we need to take the baby back, you know. And I was very sad to give it back. I knew at that point. And so, like I said, a year later, babysitting my nephew, it was like, whoa, I'm totally tripping out, because it's like, this is exactly what this kid looked like. And so now that nephew of mine, we need to do the math. I think he's about 25 now. And so I keep thinking, if I meet this roughly 25, 26-year-old young man someday that looks just like my nephew but isn't him. If I meet someone that looks a lot like my nephew but is not him, I realize he might be the kid. Because he would, I think, pass for being completely human. And you know, more and more abductees feel that they're meeting their hybrid children in daily life circumstances, much like yourself. But that seems to be on the increase. Now, in my life, I don't have any kids. I've not been married. I don't have any kids. So I haven't had that raising hybrids thing that some people do. But I keep thinking, if I meet this young man someday, who now would be roughly late 20s, that, it, again, if he looks a lot like my nephew but isn't him, then I'll think that maybe I'll know who he is. I would hope that I would be able to meet him someday. I would like that. And then jumping ahead. But meanwhile, I'd still had extreme guilt over turning away from the one little girl. And just felt like I just felt so awful, like I turned away from my own child. And so all of a sudden, I'm having an experience. I think this is about 5 or 6 years ago now. I'm driving home from California from having attended a conference, and I have missing time significantly while driving home from California on the 10 freeway. And realize that I had significant missing time, two separate exits from the freeway that I got off at, that I stopped at both of them many times, whether I needed restroom or gas or something to drink or combination. But these two stops are about an hour and a half apart on the freeway. Well, this one night they took over 4 hours, you know, between them, and there's no way that they would take that long. And I had a vague memory of getting off the freeway in the middle of nowhere on a little two-lane road, very common in abductions to find that you walk or drive to an unknown area. And I'm like, did I actually do that? Did I actually get off the 10 and drive out on this little road? Did I actually do that? You know? And then when I got home, went to bed, got up the next day. Because of the missing time, I had driven, it was in August, and I drove home specifically at night to avoid the heat, because going through Phoenix rather than it be, you know, 120, 124, you know, during the day, it'd be a balmy 92, you know. So I was able to occasionally roll down my windows and, you know, just avoid this extreme heat and occasionally be able to get fresh air and not have to have full-on air conditioning the whole time. And so, again, I drove home at night when this happened. And by the time I get home, I was originally planning to get home and in bed by about 2 a.m. Well, instead it was after 5 and the sun was coming up. But I crawled into bed, fell asleep, got up later. My leg was throbbing, and I had all my like mini blinds closed in where I lived at the time. And I went into the kitchen, pulled up, I had leggings on, pulled up my leggings and opened the front doors and turned on these awful fluorescent lights in the kitchen. So I had all the fluorescent lights on. I had the front door open, lots of natural lighting, propped my leg up on the counter and proceeded to find that I had a giant brand new scoop mark on my leg, which I then took my phone and took lots of pictures of. So I had this big scoop mark. So I had the missing time of what would have been at least 3 hours missing. Based upon it, took over 4 hours to go a distance that should have taken an hour and a half. So I knew, you know, I'd had the missing time. And now I had a big, fresh new scoop mark, which looked like, you know, I mean, for those who aren't familiar with it, like an indication of you know, scoop of skin taken, not an open wound. It was healed. But like when you first have a major scab come off and underneath it's like wrinkly and pink, you know, like when a brand new scab falls off. So it's healed skin, but it looks like new skin. It's pink and wrinkly. It looked like that, and it was quite large and deep. And I, like I said, I took a bunch of pictures of it. So it was like, okay, you've had missing time, and you have a scoop mark. Clearly, you had something happen. Well, then about a year later, long story short, I had regression therapist Yvonne Smith, who I'm very active with her CIRO, Close Encounter Resource Organization. She regressed me over it. And I had a very emotional regression. Yvonne said I was bawling my eyes out. And what had actually happened is, so during this time, this missing time, I did drive off the highway on this little road, pulled over, and realized, Melinda, you got to get back on the freeway. What are you doing? You know what this means. If you're doing this for no reason, you know, that's not a good sign. And I pulled over so I could get on like a dirt shoulder and make a wide enough turn on this little tiny little road to turn around, make a U-turn and go back to the freeway. I don't think I was that far from it, 2 miles maybe. And so when I pulled off to the right to start making the U-turn, all of a sudden a big beam of blue light came down over the car. And I was immobilized, and I was lifted up through the roof of the car. Very typical standard abduction fare. Car was left there, but I was lifted up as if there was no roof to the car and just taken up on board. When on board, there were grays, and they had me standing in a room, and over to the right, a little distance away from me, I could see an exam table, like all set up with high-tech equipment and everything, and I go, shit, you know, that's obviously for me. And I'm standing there, and they bring this hybrid woman in the room. And they bring her in front of me, and I instantly went, oh, my God, is it her? You know, and I thought I recognized her. Now, this was 25 years later, I'd have to think about the exact timing, give or take. But I'm thinking, okay, if I saw her and she was about 5 years old, and this is like 25 years later, this would be like a 30-year-old woman. And she was really skinny, really tall, would look like, for those familiar with the imagery of a tall white, you know, almost kind of albino looking, long, narrow face, high forehead, again, the big irises, blue, you know, thin hair, beautiful yet strange. And I kind of was just thinking to the grays, I'm like, is it her? And they said, oh, you know who it is. You know, and this was all telepathy with them. But I'm like, am I right? Because this was like short grays and elder grays kind of here. And they were like, yes. And I'm like, is it her? And they're like, yes, you recognize her. And I go, yeah. And they go, yes, it's her. And I immediately start going, I love you. I'm sorry. I love you. I'm sorry. You know, I love you. I'm sorry. And I just was like saying it over and over again. Like, I'm sorry I ever turned away. I've always loved you, you know, and I was like, and I was thanking the grays for letting me see her again and everything. Okay, so this goes on. And like I said, Yvonne regressed me over this, and it was very emotional. Now, there's a follow-up to this that's really quite something, quite mind-blowing. Hang on, I'm going to get something to drink here. I'm getting a little cotton mouth, all right?
Okay.
Hang on. I get a call one day out of the blue. It was a rainy night. I'd canceled my tour due to rain. And Lori Wagner, who's one of the producers from the movie Extraordinary, The Seating, along with John Sumple and Jack Roth, calls me and says, what you doing? And I said, well, I'm paying a bill at an Italian restaurant. I'm finishing up dinner. And she goes, good. Can you go somewhere alone and because I have something to tell you about. I'm like, oh, okay. And then she goes, and I have other people on the call with me. And long story short, she had John Semple and Jack Roth on the call. And he was in, John Semple was in Spain at the time. And I was like, aren't you out of the U.S.? He goes, yeah. And I go, what are you guys calling me about? You know, but the three of them. So one's East Coast, one's West Coast, and the other one's in a foreign country. You know, like, on what is going on? And they said, and so this phone call happened. I want to say this was 3 years ago now. And they said, well, so they said, go out and, you know, so I went out and sat in my car, and they said, are you sitting down? I go, yeah, I'm in my car. So yeah. and they said, well, we just got off the phone with one of the people from the movie. And I went, oh, and until I have this person's permission to use their name, I'm going to hold that out. But this person has young children, and they said, this morning, one of her young children had an abduction and came into the room completely awake after their experience and proceed to say, Mommy and Daddy, I just had an experience with the little doctors and the usual stuff the kids would say. And this was not uncommon for this family. It's well-known abductions run in families, and it did in this family for sure. And he proceeded to say, tell his mommy all about the abduction that he just had. But then he said, the pretty alien lady told me to tell your friend Melinda. Now, this kid has never met me, doesn't know I exist, has never seen this movie. This movie is not appropriate for young children. Anyone who's seen it would understand that. It'd be a little scary for kids. And they wouldn't get it, you know. So not appropriate for kids. This family keeps the children very isolated from the subject matter. They really don't even let them watch sci-fi or anything.
Well, Melinda, this is so fascinating, and it's so fascinating, in fact, Free Dreamlanders, that I hope that you decide to subscribe in order to hear the rest of this remarkable story. Subscribers, we will just keep on keeping on, and I would suggest you check your seatbelts, tighten them, and listen up. Melinda Leslie's website is ufosightingtours.com. Join her on one of her tours. I think you probably will be very satisfied with the results because she usually gets them.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.